All right. Bloodied Ghost, a 2/2 flyer, and I can Woe Leech off the counter. Interesting. This will table, so this is this set especially, it's super important to plan out your tables. Recurrent Bliss is, I mean, it's only bad for time considerations because you have to push okay at the beginning of every upkeep, you know? And you can like yield to it, but it's like, you know, it's just like an annoying addition. That's the only reason the thing is bad about it. Worm Harvest is definitely awesome in the right circumstances, but Savage Conception is probably better on the whole. This is going to be a card that's going to be difficult to beat without, like, getting a huge head start with Resplendent Mentor. And this is the card that's going to let me deck them, going to 70 life and Mistfell Plainsing them to kill them. All this being said, Recumbent Bliss is definitely the pick, and I'll hope to table the Kithkin Zealot. There's a Kithkin Zealot that I can table. Night Sky Mimic can get out of hand really fast. If I get, any of the Mimics can get out of hand really fast. That's the cool thing about this set. And especially because the other black-white cards aren't really all that attractive if they don't have the Mimics to back them up. And other people are drafting the cards that support their own Mimics over what would be good normally. Suture Spirit is not as good as it looks, especially if I'm going to be playing Forests. It's also just really like expensive to hold down the fort with it. And with Wither going all around, the Regenerate doesn't even work a lot of the time. The Kithkin Zealot will definitely table, so I'm not going to take it. The Spell Duster is an awesome sideboard card against a lot of decks that have a lot of enchantments, like for example my deck, if I was playing something similar. And this card's really cool if I'm anticipating flyers. I can also take this because I'm playing Binding Tether and Presence of the God. But I'd rather get a head start with Night Sky Mimic because I need the two drops anyway. And it gets me in a position to do, you know, a four damage here, and kind of whittle away at them and then kill them later. I'm still wanting that Stenzen Enlistment, the most important card in this deck. I'm talking about this deck like it's a, you know, the only thing I can draft. And I'm open to being a little bit biased here. And I think it's worth mentioning that this is a really good option over Gatecrash. Man, my Gatecrash drafts have been really, really offensive. They are just bad. I mean, I try my best to learn and maybe like through my mistakes, there's something that's to be gained from it, but geez, I just don't know how. I can't connect to the format. I don't know what it is about the format that I'm missing because it seems like it's just like really tough to grasp the, you know, intuitive value of cards and the idea of what's like how your deck's sculpted and what's better in certain circumstances and also what to expect from the opponents. Man, that set is really difficult. But this set, I feel much more comfortable. Just like Cube, it's just like easy. For me to come to conclusions, whether they're right or wrong. I don't have to worry about them all the time. Ballyknock Trapper is definitely the best card in this pack. It's just, you know, the 4-mana, tap for 0, and you can attack with it because you can, you know, play a white spell every turn. Tap it, you know, attack with it, untap it, go. I'd like to take this because you get two creatures and it's black-white from a Night Sky Mimic, but it's just not better than the Tapper. Sentinel Enlistment, there we go. Now I'm fine. That's all I needed. I have the removal, I have the lockdown on the ground, I have the mentor, I have the Woe Leecher, I have the medic, I got it all. So now it's just a matter of making my deck the best it can be. Once you have all the pieces, then you can just draft on power. But if you don't have all the pieces, then you have to draft other cards that like fill the role. Without like a medic and a Resplendent Mentor, you have to realize like you can't like reach that critical mass of life or get that impenetrable board position. Okay, nothing in this pack I can cast except for Wicker Bough Elder. I am going to be playing green for Presence of the God, and, I mean, it's just, this card's just awesome. There's always a target for it. I suppose I could play Beckon Apparition, but I'd rather just table it. And Beckon is better than it looks as well, because you're able to remove a persist creature, and there's a lot of those, so it actually has tangible value. Like, it doesn't just, like, remove, like, you know, a scavenge creature, you know, has like real value, and the 1/1 is not nothing, and it turns on Night Sky Mimic, but then again, I'm not sure how relevant that's going to be. I had big dreams, but I'm not sure it's going to come through. Wicker Bough is just a great card, so maybe I can just play like, if I don't have that much like 3-white, you know, cards, like I don't have a lot of the 2/2 Double Striker or Unmake, if I don't have any of those, then I can, no problem, play a 6 forests and feel fine about it, which is enough to turn this on. This is an interesting card. I normally don't like this card, but with Presence of the God, I mean, I can make three tokens a turn with this, and then it has the ability to pump my guys after I make the tokens. It actually works perfect. It's like it works in tandem exactly the way I want to. This is a card to look out for in this format. You could be like from you think you're going to be just fine to dead in a matter of seconds. With between Barkshell Blessing and Double Cleave, you can just be taking 20 if you don't block the right way. So watch out. Medicine Runner also with that, remember that 2-2 Bloodied Spirit? That it's really a 3-3, but they put a minus counter on it for 3 mana. This card, you know, is a cool like curve with that in mono white if you're going really aggressive. Oh man, there's that card I was talking about, that 2-2 Double Striker. Now, since I'm playing so much green, I feel worse about playing this card. But I'm pretty sure I just still take it. It's kind of, you know, it's a 4-2. It has first strike. It's pretty good. I could just take Kithkin Spellduster instead. I mean, I am going to be wanting to play a good amount of forest, maybe like 5. I guess I don't need to play Biting Tether, but I might still. And I think Spellduster is a better inclusion. I don't want to have to put myself behind a card like this. It's just too low impact, and I'm not aggressive enough to play it. I don't have any pump spells for it. Twinblade Splasher is not nothing, but I'm not really all that happy with it either. 3-3 Wither is just like not enough to like make me bend over for it and make it work. Talara's Bane, another card that people board into when you're mono white that you can't beat. I say that's a little hyper, like, you know, a little hyperbolic. You're capable of being it, but it's just like very good against you. If it takes your mentor, you're in bad shape. There's a lot of removal in this format. It doesn't actually kill the creature. There's, you know, so it's nice to be able to take away all the ways they have to deal with it. This is a card that on the wrong creature can do some huge damage, so I gotta watch out for that. I think I've seen two of those so far. Okay, there's the Zealot. It tabled, although now that I'm here and I'm more green than I thought I was, Savage Conception is an interesting and attractive option for me. So I am going to take that, both because I don't want to play against it and because, realistically, I could probably play it. But I like the 1-3 also. Now I can take the 1-3, no problem. Banishing Knack is cool. If you have like Pillow Palace and a bunch of the untapped guys, this one is a little bit like tricky that you can just like upheaval your opponent. It's certainly something to watch out for when they have one blue up. Zealot is better than the Sutra Spirit because it's your long game is so good that you don't really need to have this regenerate ability, and it's triple white to do that. And Kithian Zealot as a 1-3 immediately gives you that defensive position. I wish I had two of them, but I can't, you know. Savage Conception, given the way my deck's going, is actually going to be pretty playable. So let me just start hiding this stuff. I'm at 28 cards, so I feel pretty good about it. All right, so my internet went down at the very end here, and luckily I just missed the very, very last picks. So it should be fine now. I don't think I missed anything of huge relevance. Like I could have picked up maybe like I don't know, something over, you know, this 2-1 maybe. There's like one more pick where I think there was a card that was of value. Moonhole, what does this do? Yeah, it's just bad as I thought it was. Very interesting card. I guess if you play on turn 3, they can't play a land or a creature that like puts you pretty far ahead. That's kind of interesting. Pretty difficult to make that good in a deck. So let's put in all the cards that I could see playing and then cut those ones that I don't want to play anymore. So this is 24 exactly. Nivea's Wisps is not a card I'm particularly happy about playing. I'm not even the least bit sad about cutting it. Biting Tether is probably asking a bit much from a card. It's a good card. Nothing against it. Very, very good card. I just think that the green I have is much better, and I think it's more important that I play like enough white and enough green and don't worry about the Biting Tether. Maybe I can board into it if their creatures are really, really good. That's another thing with this format, is that the creatures really aren't that good in this format. They're either the Seed Cradle Witch or other like kind of like low, like guild mages, basically, where it's going to die. Or they're Persist creatures, which is not good with Biting Tether either, because they're going to get them back if they kill it, or it won't have, you know, just they're small to begin with. And there's like Divinity of Pride and like the, you know, Deuce of Calamity, and those cards are the ones you want to take with it. But it's, you know, that's why boarding into it's much better. Like, for example, it wouldn't be very good against my deck. so I can use that as a point of reference. Hyper aggressive red decks also have cards that I wouldn't want to steal. It's just a 5-mana removal spell that I can block with if I take an untapped deck. So this is 17 lands, but I'd like to play 18 lands because I have Sen's Enlistment and Savage Conception. I want to make sure that I have enough lands, so it allows me to play more lands and not have it be I won't flood anymore. So it lets my openers have a better chance of being keepable by playing 18 lands. I've had decks where I've played 19 lands with like two Sen's Enlistment and just like a lot of mana sinks because you have a definite use for your lands. It's kind of like landfall where you don't feel bad about playing more lands because they're basically both spells and lands. Misfield Plains is why this is able to work because I can always push the game to the end I can always force them to make moves. They have to make moves early because the more I stabilize, the more I'll eventually win by decking. And they don't have that option. So I guess that means I cut Nivea's Wisps to now I'm at 20. I'm at 18 lands because I put the Mistfield Plains in there. Night Sky Mimic is pretty bad, but it's a 2-drop, and I think I have to play it. I wish I had more 2-drops. I wasn't actually anticipating having these few 2-drops. Kind of abnormal for this deck. Maybe I should have played around that a little better, but typically it doesn't happen like that. I'm really glad there wasn't a lot of anti red cards. There's usually like Chaotic Backlash, Ember Gale, and there's like this 2/1 like Arsonist. Something arsonist for red, where it kills a plains or a scarecrow. It's like a 2/1 for three, and that's really, really good against me too. But didn't see those. Those are the cards you have to hate because this deck thrives on the fact that there's not a lot of flyers in the format. There's like Silkbind Fairy, Wasp Lancer, that like blue cohort 2/2 flyer, and after that, there's like not really anything that flies. So it's very strange in that regard. All right, well let's just put the lands in, see where we're at. Let's put in 7 forests and 10 plains. So I have 11 white sources and 7 green sources. That's probably a little high. Probably don't need that. Steel of the Godhead, I might not need. I don't really have a creature to put it on outside of Kithkin Ravel and Thistledown Duo. The rest of the cards to put it on basically just they don't really it doesn't cut the mustard really. Like I just a kind of a lifelink ability that I'm gonna be able to get life other ways. Kind of like I'm defensive already, so maybe I just don't need it. I can board into it if I feel like it's going to be pretty good against my opponent. Mine Excavation, I have two Presence of the Gond, a Witch, Watchman Scarecrow, a Recumbent Bliss, that's four. And if I had like two more, it would be a really good option, especially considering that if they don't kill the Presence of the Gond, either the creature or the Gond itself, it's going to be pretty tough for them to win if I get a good position. I'm just going to play Nivea's Wisp because it's good early, it's good late, and it's good against a card like Runes of the Deuce, where it could just bowl me over out of nowhere. There's also Shell Skulkin, 4 mana for 3/2. I don't want to have to play a card like that, but there's always that too. So 18 lands with a cantrip makes me kind of want to play 17 lands with two cantrips, but because I have two retrace cards, I actually kind of like playing 18 and a half lands. I think it's closer to like 18.4 lands. I don't know what the actual math on that is. This definitely doesn't feel like half a land. I like the way that my deck's turned out. The Watchman Scarecrow is a really great blocker at a 2/4, even if it doesn't have flying. Normally, it's a lot better than it is. It's like an Azure Drake. It's really good. But the way it is, it's certainly a card that's worth playing. See you for round one. Woo.